Hello and welcome to the second video in this series made for 24-hour answers, where we look at becoming a better programmer. This time we're going to be examining basic data types and how you integrate these into your programs, some key differences between seemingly similar types, modifiers you can use with these types, and how you might manipulate these data types as variables. You'll find most of these data types in one form or another in any programming language, but we'll be focusing on C and C++. Rather than start with program code, I'm currently displaying a list of the data types with a brief description. We'll go over these now before looking at using them in the wild. Integers, type int, are single whole numbers. By default, they can be either positive or negative. Integers take up 4 bytes of memory, giving them a range from minus 4 billion to plus 4 billion. Generally speaking, you'll want to use these to represent numbers in systems where you need the flexibility to represent more than a limited range of data. For example, the number of entries in a database, counting large repetitions of loop statements, and any other kind of ranking, score, or number you may encounter. They're probably the most common numeric type. If you find yourself requiring even larger numbers, you can employ what's known as a long long. The naming of this type comes from the fact that a long is a data type typically the same size as an integer. As such, this is just a large integer and has the same constraints, only whole numbers. This type uses 64 bits, or 8 bytes, and ranges from a negative to positive 2 to the power of 63. It will almost certainly be more than big enough for any purpose you'll have in common programming. In the other direction, you can economize with smaller data types and use a char, short for character. These types are designed to represent single letters, but can be used as numbers just as easily. To the system and compiler, the letter A and the number 97 are in fact the same. If you're interested, the number 65 corresponds to an uppercase A. Using 8 bits or a single byte, these values range from minus 128 to 127. Later on, we'll see how to use arrays of chars to represent character strings in C, and how to do the same in C++. These are the main integral types. Alongside these are floating point numbers, that is, numbers that contain a decimal point. These are handled by two types, the float and the double, which refer to single and double precision floating point numbers. The float reserves 23 bits to represent the fractional part of the number, and this gives you an effective precision of 7 decimal places. In general, you'll find this is useful for storing information like currency when completing programming assignments, but due to rounding errors, this would be very bad practice in industry, particularly in the financial sector, although I can assure you it still happens. The double type offers you 16 decimal places and a larger range. If you're performing or calculating fractional arithmetic, this is the safest type for you to use, but bear in mind the limitations of this numeric type. It is still prone to errors in rounding. If you make it into industry as a programmer, you may find sectors where even more precise mathematics are required, like programming aviation or safety equipment, and in this spirit, there are even larger and more precise data types available. This is, of course, beyond the scope of this video. The next point for consideration are the modifying keywords you can use with these data types, but I'm going to focus on one in particular, unsigned. The others, short and long, are less commonly used, and you'll often find that a certain type and modifier combination is identical to another. The unsigned keyword, however, is useful and distinctive. It converts a type from allowing negative to positive ranges, like minus 128 to 127, to permitting only positive numbers. Thus, an unsigned char becomes 0 to 255, an unsigned integer becomes 0 to 8 billion instead of 4, an unsigned long long becomes 0 to 18 quintillion, and so on. This is useful for squeezing larger values out of the same amount of memory. Whilst it's very easy, given the power of modern computers, to simply throw around the largest data type available at any point, it's good programming practice to bear in mind that there is always an optimally efficient way of writing a program, so as to use the least memory or the fewest operations. Making the correct judgments will mean you can write more robust and terse code that achieves the same goals more efficiently than others. Now we've seen these types, let's look at how to use them in actual programs. The program on screen here is very simple. It creates each of the data types that we've mentioned and sets them to a value, then prints their value to the screen. This also expands upon the printf method to show you how you can display these values. The code here has been written in the main function, which you should remember from the last tutorial. The code is actually broken into blocks and makes use of comments, which we haven't yet covered. These double forward slashes indicate text that the compiler will not use. It's designed to be read by people and not machines. Getting into the practice of documenting and commenting your code is a great head start if you wish to become a programmer in industry, and such good practice will help distinguish you as an interview candidate. These lines will be ignored when the program is compiled and executed. The first block of code demonstrates simply printing an integer. You'll recognize the printf method, but it's had some changes from last time. Now, instead of just printing a message, we're printing a token, the percent symbol followed by the letter, and after this message is a comma with our variable. This means the function now takes two arguments, the string format and then the variables of that format. In fact, printf can take any number of tokens like this with any number of variables, one for each token. Speaking of variables, between our two printf lines is our first variable statement. This is actually broken into two parts. Firstly, we have the variable declaration, int myInteger. This tells the compiler to create an integer and name it myInteger. You can use any name for your variable consisting of letters, numbers, and underscores, although you cannot start with a number. The second part of the line is the variable initialization, where we set myInteger to store the number 10,000. You must always remember to initialize variables you have declared. After forgetting to end lines in a semicolon, this is probably the second most common mistake you'll encounter. It is, however, much more dangerous. Before initialization, the variable could contain literally anything. It's just a chunk of memory on your system. To make matters worse, use of an uninitialized variable will not cause a compilation error. In fact, it may not even outwardly cause noticeable problems at all, so take care. That aside, these two lines declare an integer, set the value to 10,000, and then print it. The next block of code, labeled char, demonstrates the interchangeable nature of char types. The mycharA variable is initialized as the letter A. Note the use of single quotation marks here. This is touched upon in the last lesson. If you want to use characters, set them with single quotation marks, whereas character strings, on the other hand, require double quotation marks. For the record, escape characters like our \n are classified as single characters when they appear on their own. MycharB is initialized as the number 65, which is the numeric value of A. The next four printf lines require some explanation. The first two print both mycharA and mycharB as integer types, hence the use of %i. The two lines after print the characters as character types, which is why %c is used instead. When we run the program, you'll see the number 65 printed twice, and then the uppercase letter A printed twice. This next block, demonstrating long-long, is simpler. It simply demonstrates that we can have very large numbers with long-long types. The token to print this type is %LLD. The double float block is more interesting. Both myfloat and mydouble are initialized to the same value, 0.5 with a number of zeros and then a 2. Because the float only has 7 characters of precision, when you run this program, it will display only 0.5 for the float. The double, on the other hand, will display the full number, including the 2. The %12F token here is used to display a floating point number to 12 digits of precision, which is enough to demonstrate this concept. Finally, I've shown the unsigned modifier at work. Firstly, we have an unsigned char set to 250. This value is larger than a regular signed char could hold. Secondly, we've attempted to set an unsigned variable to a negative to see what happens. When you run this program, you'll see that the -1 is printed instead as 255. Play around with different negative numbers and see how they get converted. This will also give you an indication as to how the computer stretches out the same amount of memory to include twice as many values. Note for unsigned variables, we print with a %u and that all these tokens are case sensitive. And that's about it. I've shown the program output here. Try to replicate this program and change the values or add and remove unsigned modifiers. And if you're feeling ambitious, try putting multiple tokens and several variables into a single printf statement to see what you can come up with. As always, feel free to post any questions below.